Evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Good to see everyone tonight. Already been had a good day in the House of the Lord already, haven't we? Really enjoyed this morning, enjoyed Billy's word this morning. Looking forward to Pastor bringing the word a little bit later on. So good to be here tonight, and a big warm welcome to those watching online as well. There's nowhere else we'd rather be, sure there isn't, than here in the House of the Lord, just praising Him and lifting Him on high. So a big warm welcome to everyone. Just our services for the upcoming week are as normal. Don't forget we're here tomorrow morning, 10:30, for our prayer meeting, our Monday morning prayer meeting. So it'd be great to see us along at that. If you can't make it out, why don't you take 5 or 10 minutes, even wherever you are, just for a time of prayer, tomorrow morning around 10:30. At 6:30, 7:30 on Tuesday evening is Lighthouse Kids. And then 7:45 is our midweek meeting and prayer meeting. Pastor will be bringing the devotional this Tuesday evening, so look forward to that. And Wednesday morning is Mums and Tots as always, so just keep that in your prayers from 10 to 12. And then on Friday evening, Thrive Youth from 7 to 9. We're here again next Lord's Day. Paul will be bringing the word next Sunday morning, and Pastor will be bringing the word next Sunday evening. Don't forget, as I said this morning, about our Christmas fellowship night on the 14th of December, only a couple of weeks away. If you're coming along to that, put your name on the wee sheet at the back there, and also write down what you're planning to bring that night. It'll be a good night for us all to be at. So just remember that on the 14th. We'll open up on a word of prayer, and then we'll hand over to the praise and worship team.
Bless the Lord.
Lord, we thank you, Lord, that we're found in your house once again, Lord. Another opportunity for us to gather together as a group of brothers and sisters, Lord, just to lift your precious name on high. Lord, that name which is above every name, Lord. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for what has already taken place in your house today. Lord, it was just lovely to be in your presence earlier today. And Lord, there's nowhere else we'd rather be than here in your presence once again this evening, Lord. Lord, we just pray, Lord, that everything that's said and done would be satisfactory to you. And Lord, as we always pray, Lord, that you would be glorified and magnified.
Hallelujah.
In this place this evening.
Yes.
You are so worthy of our praise. Lord, bless Pastor as he brings your word later on. Lord, thank you for Pastor. Thank you for Lynn. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you be with them, that you be with our family circle, Lord. Lord, that you keep them safe, that you keep them healthy. Lord, that you keep them well, Lord. And Lord, that you would have your hedge of protection around them, Lord, giving them fruits for their labor. And our prayer is, Lord, that somebody would come to know you as their Savior tonight, Lord.
Jesus.
Lord, that they would have been watching earlier on, that they were here earlier on, Lord, and heard the word from Billy, Lord, that they'll be listening in tonight, Lord, and hear the word from Pastor, Lord.
Jesus.
Lord, they'll hear the word from you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
And Lord, we just pray, Lord, that you'd speak in to their hearts, Lord, and Lord, that we would hear of new names being written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Lord, we will be mindful to give you and you alone the glory. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that we serve a healing Savior tonight, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that there's nothing too difficult for you, Lord.
Yes.
And Lord, we pray, Lord, for those that need that touch, Lord. Lord, that you just place that healing hand upon them. Lord, Pastor sends out the list every Monday morning, and it just seems to get longer and longer every week, Lord. And some names have been appearing on that list for long periods of time. But Lord, we thank you and we praise you, Lord, that you are the great physician.
Oh, hallelujah.
So Lord, we just pray for complete and full healing upon those that would need that tonight. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you would surround them with your peace,
yes,
which surpasses all understanding.
Bless the Lord.
Lord, we love you tonight. Lord, we praise you tonight. Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, Lord, and for your love and for your mercy, Lord. Lord, we genuinely don't know where we would be tonight, Lord, if it wasn't for you. So, Lord, we thank you and we praise you for all of these things. We ask it all in your name. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
To the ground. Lord. Hallelujah.
How wonderful and
Absolutely love that old hymn that we just sang there at the end, and I'll tell you why. I don't know if I've shared this with you before, but forgive me if I have. The reason why I love that old hymn, that hymn in our family started a wonderful snowball effect. I'll tell you how it all began. A dear old uncle of mine, he's actually my father's uncle, who was an incredible man of God. And I look at him and I look at me, I'm a pygmy in comparison. This man done great exploits for the Lord, and I thank God for him. He set a precedent. Anyway, before he was saved, he worked in Mackey's foundry. And the chap that he was a journeyman, and his apprentice came along, and this young fellow was saved. And of course, my uncle at the time wasn't saved, and this young fellow was always singing, always happy, always delighting in the Lord. Imagine being a Christian like that, folks, delighting in the Lord and singing joy unto the Lord. Yeah, praise his wonderful name. But anyway, this rattled my uncle. But anyway, he constantly sang that song. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful. And my song shall ever be. And he couldn't quite figure this out. What's this all about? What's all this about? But anyway, the Spirit of God began to work, praise the Lord.
Amen.
And my uncle was saved. Not long after that, my aunt was saved. Then her sister, who was my grandmother, she was saved. Then my grandfather was saved. Then my great-grandfather was saved. And he was a staunch Presbyterian Orange man, grandmaster and all that sort of stuff. He was there, wasn't saved. Anyway, that's another story. And then, of course, it goes down a level. No, I don't mean a down a level, down the next generation. Dads get saved. My uncle gets saved. My aunt gets saved. My mother gets saved.
That
continues. And not only that, was only our part of the family. In other parts of the family, uncles get saved, their wives get saved, their children get saved. And out of that, there was missionaries sent to the other side of the world. There are people who are in God's work. It's incredible. And then it comes to our generation. And it's all because somebody got annoyed. Hallelujah. May we annoy people with the joy of the Lord, that they see something in us and ask the question, say, what's this all about? Why are you happy all the time? Do you need locked up? Yes, we probably do. But, folks, there is something about knowing the joy of the Lord. It truly is our strength, folks. It truly is. And do not ever underestimate the power of a hymn or an anointed song. Praise the Lord. If you have your Bible with you, turn with me to Philippians 1. I've had one of those weeks where my head was all over the place. You ever get a week where your head's all over the place? Yeah. Well, no matter what you try to do, you sit down and you try to read, and you're reading and you're going, what have I read? Or you're trying to put something together and you go, what have I put together? Just one of those crazy, crazy weeks. Anyway, but the Lord's good, and he's always faithful. Philippians chapter 1, please. I will break into the chapter at verse 21, and this is a powerful, powerful statement. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor, yet what I shall choose I wot not. For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. And we'll just stop there because we know we could read on. But for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. You know, there's a wonderful verse of scripture in Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and verse 1. And somebody tells us this, that to have a good name is a good thing. There's nothing wrong with having a good name. But it also comes off with a line, and this is written by the smartest man outside of the Lord Jesus who ever lived here on this earth. That was Solomon. But he said this, that the day of your birth is good, but the day that you die is so much better. Mm-hmm. Folks, we come into a world, and I don't know how long we've got, but the Lord knows. I believe that your life is planned out from day one until the end. Bible simply tells us it's appointed unto men once to die, and after this, the judgment. And thank God we've been spared the judgment. We've been spared the great white throne. We have been spared hell and the lake of fire. Glory to God for that. If that's not enough to stir you, I don't know whatever will. You're saved. Glory to God. But of course, we also still have to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, where those deep thoughts, those things in the recesses of our hearts will be judged. Sins covered with the blood, but perhaps the things we didn't do, perhaps the things we didn't say, times that we never stepped up for the Lord, those will be the things that we'll probably be judged. I believe we'll be judged on. But what a wonderful thought to know that we are gloriously, gloriously saved. But folks, here's the thing. I want to ask a question here this evening. What are we living for? Because Paul says this. I have to remember too, this man's in jail at this time. And when you read through the book of Philippians, right from the off, it is the most buoyant of all the epistles. If you don't read that with a smile on your face, there's something wrong. When you read it from the very start, right to the very end, he just says, oh, it's wonderful. The consolation of Christ. This is a man who's chained to a wall, who's being beaten daily, and yet he said, I can do all things through Christ who strengteneth me. What a wonderful thought. Hallelujah. But then he begins to think, he says, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Folks, in our little lives that we have here, we don't know how long we've got. It'll 70 years, 80 years with strength. Maybe 100 years. You might get a letter from whoever's on the throne at that particular time. Or if you're an Irish citizen, you'll get a wee bit of money from the president. You don't take your choice, whatever way you want to be. Yeah. However, we don't know. We don't know what will happen at the end of it all. But here's the thing. Whenever it'll come to a point where it stops, but whenever we pass into eternity, it'll never end.
Sure.
It continues. And it continues, and it continues. And when we get to heaven, oh, what a wonderful, wonderful thought. When we get to heaven, folks, we get there. Like Billy mentioned this morning, where like literally just 1,000 years is like one day. Amen. What a thought. And when we've been there, the hymn writer says, 10,000 years. There'll be no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Amen. But here's the thought for us this evening. I want to leave this with you tonight. Just to challenge ourselves and to encourage. Because I want our Sunday evenings to be an evening when we come home and go away encouraged, because there's too often when we go away we go, whew, that was a hard one tonight. How many of us have sat in meetings where you've felt as if you've been in the trenches, you put your tin hat on, and just went, yeah? No, not that. We don't need that, praise the Lord. But we do need challenge at times, and we need to build up on our faith. My question simply is very, very simple this evening. In our life, in this life, which is Paul says, I live as Christ. Are you enjoying it? Are you receiving the benefits and the blessings of it? Do you wake up in the morning and think to yourself, well, I know I've got 1,000,001 problems and 1,000,001 things I have to face today, and maybe 1,000,001 people, I know I'm exaggerating terribly, but you've got people that you're going to meet who have 1,000,001 problems. You know, but the thing about it is this, are you enjoying your Christian life? I heard a testimony there recently. I was about a preacher, and he got a phone call, and the lady, she says, I was given your number. I'll not tell you who it was from, but you're the fifth person that I have rung, and the last person said, if this man can't give you the answer, then nobody will. And she says, well, what's your question? She says, give me one reason to live. Give me one reason to live. She says, because if you don't give me that one reason to live, I'm ending my life tonight. This is the last night that I'll be on earth. So the man, he says, ask me that again. Ask me the question again. And all he was doing, he was composing his thoughts. And she said, give me one reason to live. And he said to her, do you know what you need? And she says, what's that? She says, you need a friend. You need a real friend. Let me tell you about a friend. Let me tell you about one who sticks closer than my brother. Let me tell you about the friend who I am. And share a little piece of his testimony about the night that God saved him and brought him from his very own pit, lifted him out of the miry clay and set him upon the solid rock. He says, I'll tell you about that. I'll give you one reason. I'll give you a million reasons to live. And it's all in one person. And it's the Lord Jesus Christ. And the phone call only lasted a few moments. But by the end of the phone call, he had prayed with her and had led her to the Lord. Glory to God. And of course she said, will you come and will you visit me? So he went the following day along with his wife and then through the door met this woman. And she says, you know, I've felt joy, she says, like I've never felt joy before. Why? Because she'd come into this knowledge that Paul was speaking about. For me to live is Christ. Woo! All the benefits of being saved. All the benefits of knowing, no matter what I have to face, he is there. No matter what comes our way or who comes against me, he is there. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of God will raise up a banner against him. Glory to God. What a wonderful, wonderful thought. Are you enjoying the Christian life? And yes, there's times whenever it's difficult. Yes, there's times whenever it's hard. But listen, nobody ever said it was going to be easy. If the preacher sat down beside you, whoever it was, and led you to the Lord that night, and said, you know what? That's it, all your problems will disappear in a moment. No, they don't. Sometimes the problems only begin to multiply the moment that you're saved. I'm sure there's plenty could testify to that. You know, and I remember reading a number of years ago about John Lennon. John Lennon was seeking for, he says, there has to be something more out there. And they had tried all of the crazy Indian gurus, they had all that stuff. And he met a Christian in America and he said, listen, if you trust Jesus, all your problems will disappear. And he thought, that's what I need. That's exactly what I need. But then he suddenly realized it doesn't work like that. And I don't know what way John Lennon left this world. I'd love to say he was saved, but he certainly never didn't live it. He didn't certainly leave any testimony behind. But he was so disillusioned with it all. He said, there's nothing in that. It's the opium of the masses. There's nothing there. There is something. It's real. Very, very real. When the Lord calls and he begins to move upon your life. Folks, life, I didn't start up in notes yet. In life, we'll all have our problems. We'll all have our trials. And we'll all have our situations to face. That's just the way that it is. It's the choices that we make in those things. I mean, Paul goes on to say, if I live in the flesh, we don't want to live in the flesh. Because when we live in the flesh, we do what? We do the things that we don't want to do. I said last week, I believe I was being honest and candid, but whenever I'm not walking close with the Lord, and please forgive me for being personal, but there are times, you know exactly what I mean. When you haven't been spending time alone in the book, when you haven't been spending time alone with the Lord, and I mean, you've been getting up in the morning, you've been reading a couple of scriptures and running out the door as fast as you can, and maybe a wee bit later on, and maybe you listen to something with the iPod, or something, some of those things. But you're not getting away alone with the Lord. Billy, I'm picking on you again. You know, when John the Baptist was out in the wilderness, what a place to meet with the Lord. He got away out solidly with God and spent time there. Do you mean, no wonder the Lord Jesus said, did you go out to watch a reed blown in the wind? Of course you didn't. You went out to see a man who was meeting with God on a daily basis, who was giving you food for your soul. That's why you went out to see him. So we don't want to live in the flesh. And I know he's talking about just living in the day to day, because we do, we make terrible, terrible judgments at times. And I will say this, there are plenty of times whenever I have said to the Lord, Lord, I'll never, as long as I draw breath, ever do that again. God forgive me. And you know, a couple of days later, I'm going back and going, Lord, the thing that I said a couple of days ago, that I wouldn't do, I've done again. The Lord knows only too well. And no wonder he says, I am straight betwixt the two. He says, you know, here's good. He says, I'm here, I'll serve the Lord. But there's something ahead, which is so much better than here. I mean, Joel Osteen's telling lies by selling a book to say, your best life here. Folks, that's for sinners. Because they're having their best life here. They really are. We have abundant life here, but we're going to have super abundance over there, which is so much better. If you're not saved, you're living your best life here. If you die and go into eternity, you're going to eternity lost. You're not going to have a good time there. Hell isn't this ongoing party. You're going to meet your friends and all have a great old hooly. It's not like that at all. It's a place of everlasting torment where the worm shall not die, the word of God says. And of course, there's weeping, and there's wailing, and there's gnashing of teeth. There's three different types of people there. Whether you bump into them or not is another thing. You'll have those who are weeping, and what are they about? They're weeping because they're going, Lord, why am I here? Why am I here? Lord, I went through all of the sacraments belonging to my church. I prayed 5 times a day according to my mosque. I did all the things that my Maharaja told me to do. I did all those things. Why am I here? They know they're going to end up there. And of course, there's the wailers. They're just going about the place with a complaint. They got man in Luke 16, wailing about why he's there. And of course, there's those that are gnashing their teeth. What is that about? It's not because they're in a corner. They are actually cursing God. They're in hell and they're, how dare you send me here? How dare you? Who do you think you are? Hell not changing you. There's no such thing as purgatory. You can't go through a wee while and come out and all of a sudden you're ready for heaven. You need to be ready for heaven here. For to be, to live is Christ, to die is gain. What about these trials and situations that we have to face? 2 Corinthians 4:17 says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. And of course, a wee bit earlier on in that same chapter, 2 Corinthians 4:8 says, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Folks, we all have issues to face. But in Christ, like what Paul said here, for to live is Christ, when we're in Christ, we get the victory. Hallelujah. 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 We don't deserve the victory, but he has brought us in to the victory. So folks, how are we living? Are we walking close? Or are we walking afar off? Remember Peter, whenever he denied the Lord, whenever they took the Lord out of the garden, it was the Bible says, he followed afar off. Let's not follow afar off. Let's get close. Let's get really close. Closer. When we pray, Lord, close us in with you that we're not going to be afar off. Are we walking worthy of the name Christian? Are we bringing shame on this wonderful, beautiful name? Because I remember when I wasn't long saved, my dad sat me down and he says, listen, if you're not going to live for the Lord, don't you tell anybody you're a Christian. Don't tell them. Because they'll look at you and go, if that's Christianity, count me out. Because people watch, you know. They pretend they don't. But they watch every single thing that you do. And you know, they'll scrutinize us quicker than they'll scrutinize their mate in the pub. They don't really care about their mate in the pub, what he does. But they'll care what we say. And of course, if we slip once, oh boy, never worry about all the good things you've ever done for them. They remain where we're at. And it should 30, 40 years even pass and go, oh aye, but I remember. And the wonderful that the Lord has cast all of our sins into the sea of his forgetfulness. Hallelujah. I know each of us say exactly the same thing, that we long to be living closer. Following closer, living closer, praying more, praising more, reading more, serving more. None of us are perfect, but are we prodigals? Or are we the real deal with the true born Isaacs? Are we living to please ourselves and doing what's right in our own eyes? We thought about that a number of weeks ago. Or are we seeking to please God in all of our ways? Even when nobody's watching. Can you say, Lord, I want to please you. When you're out of the eyes of men and out of the eyes of everyone, is your life still fitting? And my goodness, I can say this, I fall very short at times, and that's the truth. I really do. I know personally, I long for a closer walk with the Lord. I long to live a life more pleasing to the Lord, to be able to say this with an assurance. For me to live is Christ-like. In every facet, it's Christ-like. To die is gain. Are we living like true priests of the Lord? In that we live with our minds renewed daily? Are we living truly living sacrifices to the Lord? Which is not only our duty, but when we do that, then we enter into what? The will of God for our lives. What a wonderful thought. And you know, we know someone, or we know some people who tonight are prodigals, who have left the Father's house and they're living off in that far off land, and where we thank God have once left. They're back into Egypt again, but while they're there, they're nothing but strangers and foreigners and aliens. Mm-hmm. You think of the prodigal son, look where he ended up. That's where backsliders end. That's where they end up. They end up in pig pens. And you just pray, Lord, bring them to their senses that they'll come out of it. But you know, here's the thought as well too. Not all the backsliders have left the church. We can become Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and you could be as backslidden as anyone else. So we need to stay close to the Lord to have this determination. And as well, what I love about this is, you know, even though Paul's saying, you know, I need to stay here, but my desire is to be with Christ. You know, as I sat and thought about this, the question that I have to ask myself is this: if I left this scene of time tonight, and I found myself in the presence of God, would my life, I'm unsaved, I don't cover with the blood, my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, but could I look him face to face? Could I look him in the face with how I'm living right now? I trust and pray that I could. I trust and pray that I could. The devil, folks, have got so many blinded by the bright lights of the world. And the sad reality is this, that so many of those that are blinded by these bright lights are our very own kith and kin. They see us, we've been brought to the one who's the light of the world. And yet they look at us and we're so dull. They think the world looks so great. Look what it has to offer. But you know, there's pleasure in sin only for a season. And after it finishes, what's it do? It brings forth death. Whereas what we're in brings forth life. And life, eternal life in abundance. Sadly, folks, for those here in that far off country, they're miserable. They might pretend that they're happy, but they're miserable. There's no fullness in the world. It's full of just one, spiritually, full of famine and full of despair. They're wasting their lives. They're wasting their whole substance. They're wasting their money and their efforts. They're chasing after shadows. They're chasing after empty dreams. They're chasing after riotous living, the scripture says. And of course, they've got this banner over their lives where it's live fast, die young. Yeah, but okay, hold on. But what about after that? Yeah. If it ended there, it's fine. But I'll go home and just watch TV like everybody else. It doesn't end there. You know, like I say, but you're going out of one of two ways. And you know, what way are you going? Hopefully onward, upward. Praise the Lord. Live fast, die young is the cry of the world. But our question this evening is, where are you going to spend eternity? When you can have so much more. Like Paul, and like those who know the Lord, we can say, well, you know, for me to live, it's not about me. It's to live Christ-like, to live the godly life. And then, of course, at the end of it all, when it all ends, praise the Lord, that I'll depart and I'll be with him, which is so much better. Mm-hmm. And folks, this is not carrot and stick religion, you know, where you get your, it's just hung in front of us until the very end. It's blessings at his right hand, now and forevermore. What a tremendous thought.
Praise your name, Lord.
Folks, whenever you think of the flesh, it's a precarious position. Romans 8 and verse 8 says this. So then they that are in the flesh, they cannot please God. Let's not be fleshly and carnal. That's a frightening thought. The backslider, the prodigal, cannot please God. They're no longer living a life in faith. And folks, let me tell you something that is so, so easy for us to slip. The Bible says, he that thinks he stands, take heed lest he fall. I have seen it time and time and time again. And you know what I think is wonderful? God gives warnings over and over and over again. I've seen it, but sadly so many people don't pay heed to the warnings. They see other people fall and they go, oh, well, that would never happen to me. Yeah. A frightening thought. Galatians 5:17 says, or 17 says this, for the flesh lusteth, or fights with, against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. And that's so, so true, folks. We are in a battle, and the battle's within us. There are things that the enemy wants us to do. Oh, do this. It's normal. It's say whatever you want. Live however you want. And you go, well, no. We stop and we say, no. What would the Lord do? What's the Bible say? How we should have. This is our direction, praise the Lord. Remember, we are new creations in Christ, and all things have become new. The old man, the old ways, the old sins, they all pass away, praise the Lord. Christ helps us in all of our infirmities and in all our weaknesses. We may be weak, like the old chorus says, I am weak, but he is strong.
Bless you, Lord.
We need to pray for those who have backslidden, for those who no longer can take these verses and apply it to themselves. They just pray that the Lord will strengthen them and bring them back. They'll show the folly of this world and show the blessings that there are whenever they're walking close to him. Romans 6:2 says, speaking of living in sin, and the word says, God forbid, how shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? To encourage you all in your walk with the Lord, we want to be pleasing. We don't want to displease the Lord. I don't care what man thinks about me. I'm interested in what God thinks about me. Folks, just a wee thought, I want to leave you. First wee thought, and I'll be quick. We should live like priests who have been called to be priests. I believe that we are all priests. I believe we are a royal priesthood. I believe in the priesthood of believers. I know what someone say, oh, there's a level. No, there's no level. There's no level or degrees. Listen, we are all saved. We're all called. We all have an anointing. Glory to God. And God can use us all. So don't be thinking, I can't do that. That's really up to the pastor, the elders, or the deacons. Thank God for leadership. But hold on. The onus is upon you. You're called. Glory to God. You are a part of a holy nation. You are part of a peculiar people who have been called and separated unto Christ. Romans 8:1 says that we should present our bodies. That's not Romans 8:1. It's Romans 12:1. Present our bodies as living sacrifice, laying everything down and following Christ. To have that anthem for our lives, which is, I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. Secondly, to live as the Lord's own. In the Song of Solomon 6:3, it tells us, I am my beloved. You should read the Song of Solomon, guys. Read it. Read it and read it over again. And read it over again. What a love story. I am my beloved, and my beloved is mine. And he feedeth among the lilies. Live as his own. Live that you're blood bought, that you're spirit filled, that you're a born again believer, that you've been set apart by him. You're his. No longer are you the world's, glory to God. You know, I can remember Linda saved before me. I thank God she was saved before me. Only about 6 months or so. But in those 6 months, I watched her live before me as a woman of God. Praise the Lord for her. And in those 6 months, even though she was my wife, even though she was wearing the wedding band and we had the paperwork to prove it, she was not mine. She was his. That's a different thing. I could no longer treat her just with, not that I treat her shabbily. I hope not, honey. No, I didn't. Yeah. I hope I didn't treat her shabbily. But I had to buck up my ideas here, guys. She's his now. A wonderful thought. I am his, and he is mine. And you know, I think it's wonderful as well, too. He's brought us through all of these hardships and times of troubles because he loves us. Micah 7:18, one of my favorite verses in the Old Testament. Who is a God like unto thee that pardoneth iniquity and passeth by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? He retaineth not his anger forever because he delighteth in what? He delighteth in mercy. What a wonderful God we serve. We're his. Live like we're his. Called to be priests, live like we're the Lord's own. Not only that, thirdly, to live as believers. How do we do that? We stand on the promises. Should have sung that this evening. Standing upon the promises. We've been justified by his blood. Not by anything that we have done or anything we could do. We are saved by faith alone. Glory to God. We're no longer living a life according to the world, but we're living a life that we're kept by faith. Faith in Christ alone. And of course, Romans 1 and 17 tells us this, the just shall live by faith. And what we need to be living is, Christ said it, I believe it, that settles it. That's how we should be working as believers. To live justified. Love this. I'd love to say it was me that thought of it, but it certainly wasn't. It's just if I'd never sinned. Totally forgiven. Our sins forgotten. You know, our text, and I'll be quick as we close. For me to live is Christ. He is our Redeemer. Our kinsman Redeemer. You think of Boaz and Ruth. What a wonderful love story there again. He's greater again. He is our kingly Boaz. Hallelujah. We're no longer on our own, but we are His. We have been bought with a tremendous price, the shedding of His own blood. And we are washed in the blood, and we have been washed whiter than white, whiter than snow. And because we are redeemed, one day we will stand ransomed with that wonderful throne, all robed in white, around the throne of God. And not only that, but we will be brought in and we will be presented faultless, sinless, stainless in His presence. What a truly awesome thought. That's why I refer back to Ecclesiastes 7:1. Without our death here, we'll be passing into something even more wonderful than we ever experienced here. And it'll never stop. It will continue and continue and continue. Hallelujah.
Bless you, Lord.
We are redeemed. And we will be among those countless millions, dare I even say billions of others who are saved. For me to live is Christ. He is our all in all. He should be our first thought in the morning and our last thought in the evening. Our Lord of all. He's our shepherd, our Lord, our Savior, our beautiful bridegroom that we thought of. To live is Christ. Amen. Our lives should mirror His. His testimony is ours. To live in the Spirit. True worshippers in spirit and in truth. Led and guided by the Word of God. Filled with the Holy Spirit. With all the benefits of knowing that infilling. And I don't mean to say all of this stuff that you see at times. Sometimes I question. I mean the genuine infilling, indwelling of the Holy Spirit, which isn't all singing and dancing. I'll be honest with you, it's not, you know. It's not. It's all about leading a life. It's more about direction, glory to God, and thank God for that direction. But filled with the Spirit of God and all the benefits of this, being full of Him and not of ourselves. To live, as the Bible says, soberly, righteously, and godly in this world. To prove that we know this great grace of God. You know, as I close, my prayer for me and for everyone that's here and those who are watching online, you know, Lord, may I never walk in my own ways. The world, you know, one of the big songs at funerals is Frank Sinatra, I did it my way. No, when it comes to my lot, I want it to be, Lord, we did it your way. And for anyone who's taken part in it, to say, He did it God's way. He didn't go His own way. He did it God's way. And you know, one of my favorite hymns is, you know, it says, has a line, Lord, lead me, lest I stray. Gently lead me all the way. Because, folks, we can all stray off. Heaven help us when we do. And you know, of course, another hymn says that we're so prone to stray as well. What I think is wonderful, He loves us. He loves me. He calls us to be unto Himself, to be forgiven, to be brought into this wonderful kingdom, to live a better life than what we ever thought that we'd ever have, to come into that truth of knowing that He will give us exceeding abundantly above ever what we can ask or even imagine. This is the life that we can have in Christ. One day, folks, we will be perfect when we shall be like Him. Hallelujah. Lord, help us to live day by day in a way which is pleasing to You alone. As a close, I mean that this thing. Micah 6 and verse 8 says this. This is a good one for all of us. He hath showed thee, O man, what is good. And what doth the Lord require of thee? To do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with thy God. Lord, help us to be like that. And help us to be like Paul, who says, for me to live is Christ. and to die is gain. To not have a fear of death or any punishment, because we know the Lord took all the punishment for us. He took my Calvary. He took my cross. He took my sins and my sorrows. He made them his very own. What a wonderful, wonderful thought. And let's not live in the flesh, for if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor, which I shall choose I want not, for I am straight betwixt two, having a desire to depart to be with Christ, which is far better. Folks, as a funeral during the week, well, certainly we couldn't have called it a funeral. It was a celebration of a dear saint of God who's now in the presence of the Lord. You know, when I hear about the saints passing, you know, I feel sorry only for one people. And that's the family. I don't feel sorry for them. And you know, and one aspect, I don't mean this, I'm not a little jealousy, but I kind of think to myself, oh, what have they seen? Oh, they've seen the Saviour face to face. Oh, they've been brought in. They've heard already, well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into your rest. They're now robed in white. They're walking along those streets of gold. I don't feel any pain for them. I feel delighted for them. I'm thrilled for them. They're now walking in the fullness of it all.
Amen.
Because they're with Christ, which is much better. God bless his word to you tonight. I trust and pray but encourage in Jesus' name. Let's pray. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you that we can say this evening with an assurance, not because of anything that we have done, but because of all of what Christ has done, that we are now in Christ. Thank you, Lord, for the life in which we're living. Yes, there's times, Lord, whenever we go through all the humdrum of life. Yes, we have things to face, situations to look at, and all the troubles and trials. But we thank you, O God, that we're not on our own, because you never leave us and you never forsake us. And Lord, we thank you that we, day after day, we know that there's one who goes before. We thank you that there's one who is beside us, sticking closer than a brother. There's one who's making the way straight. Thank you, O God, for the lovely Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the guidance and the direction of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, we look forward to that day whenever we will see him face to face, the one who saved us by his matchless grace. Lord, I pray for your people here tonight, and for those who are watching online, that Lord, that you would bless each and every single one. And no matter what they're having to face at this time, whether it be sickness, whether it be anything to do with business and finances or family, whatever it may be, the Lord, that would get their focus off that even just for a moment and get their eyes onto you, the author and finisher of our faith. And Lord, I pray, as the old hymn writer said, that all of the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. So, Father, I pray you bless your people and do us good in Jesus' name. Lord, send revival to this little land of ours. We're pleading for it, O God. We believe it. And Father, as we're sitting here this evening, we think of the empty chairs on the other side of the hall. Lord, would you fill every single one? Fill them, O God, with seeking sinners, seeking a Savior. And Lord, I pray that we would see so many saved, O God, that the baptismal tank would never be closed. We're putting them through week after week after week, Lord. Lord, we know that you can do it. Not on any strength that we would have of our own or any ability or talent. But Lord, I pray that it all be done in and through the Holy Spirit. So, Father, have your way. Use this building. Use this people, I pray. Use this preacher standing here. Lord, I'm not much of a preacher, but we're usually all the same, I pray, in Jesus' name, that I may bring you glory, honor, and praise. And Lord, may I live a life fitting that I could say, Lord, should I even find myself in jail, that I wouldn't be saying, woe me, I am undone. But I will be able to say, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. So, Lord, I pray your blessing upon us, blessing upon our families and upon this little land of ours. And Lord, I pray that you would do us good throughout this week. Go before us and help us. And Lord, as we partake us to our homes in safety, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, guys.
Bless your name, Lord.
Hallelujah.